David Trigg, producer T-Rig. David Trigg, producer T-Rig. David Trigg, producer T-Rig. David Trigg, producer T-Rig. Thank you. David Trigg, producer T-Rig. David Trigg, producer T-Rig. David Trigg, producer T-Rig. David Trigg, producer T-Rig. Thank you. David Trigg, producer T-Rig. David Trigg, producer T-Rig. David Trigg, producer T-Rig.
Welcome everybody to this special live cast, este bienvenido a este programa especial, compartiendo el evangelio, sharing the gospel with everyone that needs hope, that needs to have peace with God in these very interesting times, especially on this Palm Sunday. I want to invite you to share this broadcast with your friends. Share this broadcast with all of the people in your life that need Jesus, that need to have peace with God in their hearts. Comparte este video con tus amigos que necesitan de Cristo Jesús. Deja un comentario aquí abajo en la pantalla, en Facebook, en YouTube, en Instagram. Estamos en vivo. We're live on Instagram. We're live on Facebook, on YouTube, on Twitch. Wherever you're watching and listening to this message of hope, leave a comment, say hello, encourage everyone with your comment, share this episode, this broadcast with all your friends. God is going to do something amazing in all of our lives. Dios va a hacer algo muy grande en nuestros corazones. Vamos a compartir el evangelio esta noche para que cualquier criatura, we're going to be sharing the gospel tonight so that young and old, no matter where you're from, where you're watching, you will hear the gospel of Jesus Christ on this special Palm Sunday evening cast here together. So let's sing first this incredible song called Everlasting God, a Okay, let's worship together. This we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the our God. You reign forever, our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. Not faint, you won't grow weary. You are the ever of my healing. You conquer those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. We worship you, Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer, you are. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not change, you won't grow weary. You are the emblem of the weak. You conquer those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. Conquer those in need. You lift us up on like eagles. Yes, Lord God, we praise you. Vamos a cantar ahora. We're going to sing a song now in Spanish. We're going to be doing a little bit of Spanish, un poquito de inglés, un poquito de español. And depending on who is here, we might go one way or the other. Pero quiero invitarlos a que cantemos esta canción que es muy linda. Se llama Canto, Canto. Vamos a cantar con todo el universo, con todas nuestras ganas, con toda nuestra fuerza. Vamos a cantar porque Él es bueno, porque Él es un Dios lindo. Así que cantemos esta. Vamos a cantar. Amamos todos de ti, cielo y tierra te adoran, los reinos se rinden, Hijo de Dios tú eres por quien, tú eres por quien, tú eres quien nos liberas. Tú eres la luz que guía, como un fuego ardiente, como Dios tú eres por quien, tú eres por quien vivimos hoy. Vamos a cantar con la música del cielo, vamos a cantar alegres. es porque escuchas cuando cantamos para exaltar tu nombre. Cantemos, amamos todo. Amamos todos de ti, cielo y tierra te adoran, los reinos se rinden, Hijo de Dios tú eres por quien, tú eres por quien, tú eres quien nos libera, tú eres quien nos liberta. Tú eres la luz que guía, como un fuego ardiente, Hijo de Dios, tú eres por quien, tú eres por quien vivimos hoy. Vamos a cantar con la música del cielo. A cantar alegres porque escuchas cuando cantamos para exaltar. Vamos a cantar con la música del cielo. Vamos a cantar alegres porque escuchas cuando cantamos para exaltar tu nombre. Let's now sing it in English. Sing, 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 sing. When we hang our praise, sing songs to G-O-C. Gloria a Dios, glory to God on this beautiful day, singing these songs of praise that are so beautiful. Vamos a cantar una más, una linda canción. We're going to sing one more in Spanish and then one more in English. A song of worship, a slow song. I have the words here in front of me because I keep forgetting all the words, but we're going to be singing these gorgeous songs of praise. Estos cantos muy lindos que nos recuerdan de la santidad de Dios. I encourage you to leave a comment below so it'll be on the screen so we can encourage each other. Les invito a que dejen un comentario, digan hola, ¿cómo están? Gloria a Dios. Para que compartan también este video con sus amigos. Vamos a hoy a compartir el Evangelio de Cristo Jesús. Para que toda persona, toda criatura que escuche este mensaje tenga la oportunidad de recibir a Cristo en su corazón como el Rey y como el Salvador de sus vidas. Cantemos este que se llama Algo Está Cayendo Aquí. Algo está cayendo aquí. Es tan fuerte sobre mí. Mis manos levantaré y tu gloria tocaré. Otra vez, algo está cayendo aquí. Es tan fuerte sobre mí. Oh, mis manos levantaré y su gloria tocaré. Está cayendo su gloria sobre mí. Sanando heridas, levantando al caído, su gloria está aquí. Su gloria está aquí. Su gloria está aquí. Algo está cayendo aquí. Es tan fuerte sobre mí. Mis manos levantaré y su gloria tocaré. Cantemos, está cayendo, está cayendo su gloria sobre mí. Sanando heridas, levantando al caído, su gloria está aquí. Está cayendo su gloria sobre mí. Sanando heridas, levantando al caído, su gloria está aquí. Su gloria está aquí. Su gloria está aquí. Su gloria está aquí. Está aquí. La gloria de Dios está aquí con nosotros. Quiero animarle, comparte este video, a que deje un comentario aquí abajo, diga hola, para que todos que estemos aquí nos podamos animar unos a los otros. I want to encourage you to share this broadcast with your friends, with people that may need the love of Jesus tonight. Amidst these very interesting times that we're going through, I want to just go through a couple of things here this evening. First, I want to just tell you how much you are loved and how special you are to me and to our family. We love you with everything in us. This morning we had, if you were here live with us this morning, we had a very special service for Palm Sunday that was very beautiful. And of course, next week is Easter, so we're going to be back here in these channels once again for our Easter service next Sunday. So I encourage you to check back in. I want to pray now as we go into the Word of God this evening, into this message that I believe God wants to share with us this evening, called How to Have Peace with God. And so I want to just invite you right now to share this broadcast once again with your friends and to get your heart ready to hear the Word of God, para que nos preparemos en esta noche para oír el amor de Dios por medio del Evangelio de Jesucristo, hablando del tema cómo tener paz con Dios. So I want to pray before we get started and to thank God for our time in worship, for our time in prayer. I also want to encourage you, as you are able to support this ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ, so that this message of hope can go out to the nations of the world, especially in these times of this virus and this global opportunity, I call it, to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. So oremos juntos. Let's pray together. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, I want to thank you and I want to praise you because you are here with us and because you have a special message for us. Lord, I pray that if one person or 10 people or 1,000 people will hear the message of Jesus Christ, that it would be fruitful in their hearts, that there would be a seed planted and there would be fruitfulness of salvation in their hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I want to talk to you tonight about this very important topic called How to Have Peace with God. How to Have Peace with God. It's no secret that right now there is a virus that is going around that is concerning many of us, that is causing panic to young and old across many cultures and nations and languages. This pandemic of this coronavirus has taken over the news. You go online and you hear about all of the dangers of this virus. People are concerned about what it could do to them. People are worried that they may be carriers, that they might be sick without even knowing it, that they may pass it on to their grandparents or to their father or mom. But I want to tell you tonight about a danger that is even greater than this virus, and that is the danger of a life without Jesus. I want to talk to you tonight about an even greater enemy of our souls, and that is the enemy called sin in a life without Jesus. And so I want to talk to you tonight about how to find peace with God. And specifically, the question that I want to answer for us is, why did Jesus come to this earth? You know, people in online and just friends that I know, they will ask me, what's the big deal about Easter? Besides all of the stuff that we've heard through the years of the bunnies and the celebrations, what's the big deal for you Christians about Easter? And so I want to answer that question to you, for you, by telling you, why did Jesus come to this earth? And I want to tell you this so that tonight you will have an opportunity to open your heart to Jesus, so that you will not be afraid of this virus or of any other concern in your heart. The first thing I want to tell you is that Jesus came to save sinners. Jesus came to save sinners. The Bible says in Luke 15 that there was a parable that Jesus told about the lost sheep. And it says in the Bible in Luke 15, the tax collectors and the sinners were all drawing near to hear Jesus. Jesus came to talk to people like you and me, to talk to ordinary men and women who had a problem. Jesus, it says in the Bible that he came to sick and to heal and to seek and save the lost. It says in the Bible that he did not come for the righteous, but he came for the unrighteous. And isn't that good news, that Jesus came to be with sinners just like you and me? Remember that I'm not talking about just you. The Bible says that all of us have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. And sometimes we think that we only can go to church if we are holy or if we have perfect lives. But the Bible says that Jesus came to be with sinners just like you and me. And isn't that great news? It also says in the Bible, ironically, that it was the Pharisees and the religious people of the time who grumbled, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." It's ironic how sometimes it is the people that are the most religious who get in the way of God. Don't let religious people in your life get in the way of the love of Jesus. Jesus has come for people just like you and me. No matter how good or how bad your life is, Jesus has come to save you. Romans 1 through 4, it says that all of us have sinned and we have all fallen short of the glory of God. No one is right in their own right. Not the religious person, not the person who is far from God. None of us is righteous before the eyes of God. All of us need a Savior. He came to you because he knows that you needed him. Jesus came into my life when I was 9 years old. When I was back home in my home country, I was in a Sunday school class, and I heard the message of hope and salvation. And I knew even at that young age of 9 years old that there was something missing in my heart, that there was something that wasn't right. Now you might think, well, what can a 9-year-old boy do so wrong that he needs to be forgiven of his sins? Maybe it wasn't that I had done so many wrong things. It was that I needed something better than my normal life. My life was beautiful, but I knew when I heard that Jesus loved me, that my life would be even better because of Christ. And in the same way, God wants to do something better in your life. He wants to take out completely who you used to be and put a brand new engine inside of your car. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17 that now because of Christ, you are a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. The second thing of why Jesus came to this earth and why we celebrate Easter is because he came because we were lost. Jesus came because you were lost. You know, it is not a secret that in the Bible it talks about, as I said earlier, that Jesus came to seek and save the lost. And in this parable of the sheep that were lost, it says in the Bible that the shepherd, he realized that one of his 100 sheep had gone missing. And you would think that he would be fine with that. He, after all, still had 99 left, right? But in that culture, especially as a young shepherd boy who were normally the shepherds of the time, his main job was to not lose any of the sheep. These sheep were the wealth of the day. This is how people in those times made a living. And so to lose one sheep would mean a loss of income. And so for that young shepherd, his world was turned upside down when he lost the one sheep. It says in the Bible in verse 3 of Luke 15, "What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it?" It's exactly what Jesus has done for you and for me. He came because you and I were lost. We have run away from the ways of God. The Bible says once again that all of us have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. The Bible says that none of us is righteous, not even one. I know you may say, well, I haven't done anything bad. I've lived a pretty good life. I don't have a huge jail problem or a drug problem. I haven't abused or killed anyone. The Bible says that who among us can cast the first stone? It's not about you living a moral life. Moral people will not go to heaven. Religious people will not go to heaven. People that are horribly evil will not go to heaven. The only people that will go to heaven are those who receive Jesus into their hearts and who are found by this Savior who loves us. In those days, it says that even though there were 99 sheep that were left, God didn't leave them because he didn't care. In that culture, it is known that most of the times a sheepdog would take care of the 99 sheep so that the shepherd could go after the one. Jesus wants to know you. He wants to do whatever it takes to come and know you and hear you and save you from your life. It is almost like if, for example, as a father or as a mother, you hear the smoke detectors go off at night. Maybe this has happened to you late at night. You suddenly hear the smoke detector and you're not sure if it's a false alarm or not. And maybe you have 4 or 5 children. What's the first thing you do when you hear that smoke detector? First, you want to go and make sure that it's not a false alarm. But let's say you're not sure. What's the second thing you do as this beeping is going on? You call out for your wife. You say, "Mary, are you okay?" And then you call out the names of all your kids. Joseph, are you okay? Billy, are you okay? Luke, are you fine? Are you okay? You call the names of all of your children. And if there is one that doesn't say, "I'm okay, Poppy," you worry and you go after every room. You go looking for that child that you didn't hear his voice until you find that he or she is okay. That's exactly how our Savior looks at you and me. He will go out of his way in the middle of the emergency that is called the coronavirus, that is called sin, to go after you, to make sure that you are safe. Jesus came because you and I were lost. The third reason why Jesus came and we celebrate this Easter season is because he came to find you and bring you back home. He came to find you from that place that you've been lately and you've been all these years and bring you back to his home. Once again in Luke 15, it says in verse 4 of Luke 15 that Jesus left. It says the shepherd left to go after that one that is lost until he finds it. And then it says in verse 5, "And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing." The Bible says that Jesus, in this picture here, in this parable, that he goes and finds that one sheep that was lost. And it says there that the shepherd boy picked up the sheep and put her around his shoulders. We know from the days of this story that sheep, as today, they weighed about 100 to 125 pounds. They weren't exactly on a diet, were they? And yet, it says that the shepherd boy went through every valley, through every stream, at the peril of his own life, to find that one sheep. And when he found it, he put it on his shoulders. He didn't care how tired he was. He didn't care how heavy the sheep was. He didn't care how thirsty this poor little animal might be. All he cared about was that he found this sheep and he brought her back home. Jesus will never stop until he finds you, until he brings you back to himself. My guess is that your whole life, God has been knocking on your door. Your grandmother has been praying for you. Your wife has been praying for you. Your mom has been inviting you to church. I am convinced, I know, because this is how the love of God works, that God has been chasing after your heart for many years. He will not stop until he finds you. He's been following many of you for many years. Will you finally let him bring you into himself? Will you finally tonight say, Lord, I want you to take my life. I want you to pick me up from the mess that I'm in, from the woundedness that I feel, from this fear that I feel in my heart that I can't get rid of. I want to know that I belong to you. Jesus came to find you and to bring you back home. The fourth reason that Jesus came is he came to find you and to rejoice with you. He came to find you and to rejoice with you. When I was a young boy, I came to this country when I was old, and I was so excited, but that excitement soon ended when I got off the plane and there was nobody there to pick me up. I didn't speak the language. I was 8, 9 years old. I was lost at LAX. My young sister, who was 6 at the time, began to cry. I wanted to cry. For a moment there, I panicked. I didn't know what to do. Where was my grandma? Where was my uncle that had said they would come and pick us up? I felt so worried and confused until finally the lady from the airline came and she took me to my grandma where they were waiting for me, and I ran to them and I felt so happy and relieved to finally be home with my grandma. It's exactly how Jesus is. He will go out of his way to find you, and when you find him and when he picks you up and when you finally embrace him, he rejoices and you will rejoice. In Luke 15, once again, the parable of the sheep, it says here that when Jesus or the shepherd picks up the last sheep, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, and he says to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. Rejoice, rejoice with me. God is ready to rejoice over you. Do you know that God isn't going to condemn you when you let him take your life? A lot of people are afraid to go to church or afraid to talk to God in prayer because they feel so unworthy. They feel condemned. They feel wounded and so far from God. Let me tell you, it's exactly who Jesus came for. He came for the wounded. He didn't come for those who are healthy. He came for those who are ill, for those who are weary and heavy laden. The Bible says that blessed are those who are poor in spirit, for I will give you rest. How did Jesus find you? If he was to find you today, how would he find you? Don't worry how great your life is or how messed up you've been. Stop thinking about all of the horrible things you've done or even about all the great things you've done. Stop thinking about how far you've gone away from God and into other religions, into spirituality. People tell me so much today that they're into spirituality, just not into religion. They're not into organized religion. I want to tell you, this is not about a religion. This is not about you being Catholic or about you being a Christian or about you going to the perfect church or about you being tied down and not having any fun. This is about you being found and forgiven by a loving Father who doesn't judge you. The Bible says in John 3:16 that for God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son so that whoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And John 3:17 is just as powerful. He says that he did not come to condemn but to redeem the world back to himself. He has come to rejoice over you. He wants to call together all of your friends, all of your family. He wants to rejoice with you and to have a party. The Bible literally says that when a lost person comes home, that the angels in heaven rejoice. That's exactly what God is ready to do this evening with you. I'm not going to judge you. God is not going to judge you. People aren't going to judge you. Only we sometimes judge ourselves. Stop judging yourself and instead come to the Savior of the world who wants to rejoice over you with singing, who wants to forgive you of your past, who wants to redeem your sins and to make you into a new creation. And that is why Jesus has come. It's what he did in my life when I was 9 years old. And that's what he wants to do tonight. And I want to now ask you a very, very important question. Are you ready to receive Jesus in your heart? Are you ready to make him king of your heart? Are you ready to put all of these fears of this coronavirus to rest and to know that your life is secure because of Jesus? Are you ready to put all of these fears about what may happen to your job or what's going to happen to your school's kids or what's to your kid's school or what's going to happen to your rental facility? And are you ready to put your trust in the Savior of the world who knows the future, who knows eternity? Are you ready to let him rejoice over you? Are you ready to put your life in Jesus's hands and to have him pick you up and put you in his arms and to call you his daughter, to call you his son? If you are ready, I want to give you an opportunity right now to put your trust in Jesus Christ, to be certain and know for sure and once and for all that if you were to die, you will be in heaven with him tonight. To know once and for all that you now are a follower of Jesus, that you are a Christian, that you are someone who is new, a new creation, that you, as the Bible says, are now going to be born again from darkness into light. Are you ready to receive Jesus into your heart and to open your heart to him, to have him pick you up? If you are saying yes to this question, if you are ready to receive Jesus into your heart, I want to give you a few steps to follow. Number one is admit that you're a sinner. Now you might say, wait a minute, Trigg, I'm not a sinner. I'm not that bad of a person. Yeah, maybe I've run a few red lights, so I got a few tickets, but come on, who doesn't? It's not about you being a good person or about you being a religious type. It's about you admitting that you have sinned and that there is nothing that we can do to match the glory of God. The Bible says that all of us have sinned and we all fall short of the glory of God. You, me, everyone in your home, everyone that you know, we all have fallen short of the glory of God. You might say, well, man, I'm a really bad person. I don't know if God can forgive me. You don't know, Trigg, what I've done. You don't know my past. I'm telling you, God knows your past and he's ready to forgive you and to wipe all of that stuff clean and to make your heart white as snow. Number two is you have to realize that Jesus died on the cross for you. You have to realize that Jesus died on the cross for your forgiveness. Now, this week that's coming up is Holy Week. And a lot of people will ask me, why are you guys Christians so into the cross and into the blood and into all this gory stuff? Isn't that kind of weird? Why do you believe in a Savior and a God who died? Isn't that counterintuitive? Let me tell you, Jesus had to die on a cross so that you wouldn't. He died in your place. The Bible says that all of us have sinned and that the wages of sin is death and death on a cross. In other words, if we were to pay the price for our sins, we should die. But because God loved us, he sent his very son to die in our place, to put his life on the line so that you wouldn't have to bring you forgiveness through his life. The Bible says that there is only forgiveness through the shedding of blood. You go to a hospital when you're injured or you're in a car accident. What's the first thing they ask you? For your blood type. If you need blood, if they have the right blood type, because there's life in the blood. It's exactly why Jesus died on a cross and poured his blood for you to give you life. And so you have to realize that you need a savior and he died on the cross for you. Number three, you need to repent of your sin. You need to repent. Now, the word repent is a very, very powerful word. It means to make a turnabout. It means when you're going down the freeway or a street and there is a sign that says no U-turn, it means that you can't make that U-turn. But isn't it wonderful when you're going down a street and it says you can make a U-turn? Aren't you excited? You're like, yes. That's what repentance means. It's to make a U-turn. It's to make a complete 180. You've been going down the wrong path. God wants you to turn around and repent, for you to turn your life around and to begin to make changes in your life so that you now are living for Jesus. Have you been living for yourself? This is the time for you to live for God. Have you been living for work, for women, for drugs, for alcohol? This is the time for you to turn back around. Have you been living with one foot in the church and one foot in the world? This is the time and the day for you to turn completely around and make Jesus number one in your life. Remember that repentance is not just being sorry for sin. It's actually stopping your life of sin, receiving the forgiveness of Christ, and walking with Jesus. Number four, you have to receive Jesus into your life. You have to receive Christ into your heart. Remember, this is not about you joining a church or about you becoming a different religion. This is about you receiving that Christ and that salvation named Jesus, the man who died on the cross, into your life. This is not about politics. This is not about a religious affiliation or a political party. This is about you saying, Jesus, I need you to enter into my life. I need to receive you into my heart and to make you the king and the savior of my heart. And I'm going to give you an opportunity in just a few minutes to do that. Number five is you got to do it publicly. And I know right here, we're not exactly in the same room. You might be watching this after the live. You might be watching this later tonight or tomorrow. Maybe someone shared this video with you that loves you. I want you right now to get ready to publicly say to Jesus in the privacy of your own home, in the publicness of this Facebook Live or Twitch or wherever you are, and to declare with your lips that you belong to Jesus. The Bible says that with our lips we declare that God is the Savior of the world. That if you are ashamed to say the name of Jesus here in private, that he will be ashamed of you in heaven. So this is a chance here in a few minutes. I want to give you a chance for you to publicly declare to everyone in your home, on your Facebook page, on your Instagram, on your Twitch, wherever you're watching me on YouTube, that you now are a follower of the one true God. His name is Jesus. And the last thing to do is do it now. Maybe saying, you know, this sounds really good. I'm really glad for what I'm hearing, but I'm going to just think about it. Let me tell you, today is a day of salvation. None of us know exactly these days what's going to happen. Just think back a few months ago when Kobe Bryant died tragically in that helicopter crash with his beautiful daughter. Life was gone for him like that. None of his millions of dollars, his success, his championships could prevent his life from ending suddenly, unexpectedly. Don't wait. Do it now. None of us know the day or the hour when Jesus will return. A lot of times, a lot of people ask me, Trig, is this virus the end of the world? Is this the beginning of the end? And I don't know when Jesus will return, but I know that he is coming back and that you and I need to be ready for his return. The Bible says that in the trumpet sound, in the twinkling of an eye, we will meet him face to face. How are you going to feel when you finally see Jesus come in his glory? Will you be ashamed? Will you run? Or will you say, my Savior, my King, I am thankful I belong to you. And the way that you know for certain that you belong to him is by doing it now. By deciding today that today is a day of salvation. Now, the devil will tell you, just wait. You know, make sure that you evaluate all your your decisions, that you count the cost, that you evaluate all the different religions. The Bible does say that we need to count the cost. So I'm not saying that you shouldn't think about what you're doing. This is not exactly for the faint of heart, but it is for those with a gap in their hearts. If you are here and there is a hole in your heart, that hole is only filled with Jesus. No woman, no materialism, no job, no spirituality or drug can fill that emptiness. No political party, no social cause, no action that you can take on this earth can fill that gap called Jesus Christ. Maybe you're someone who grew up in the church, or you had a friend or an uncle or a grandmother who told you about Jesus. Decide today to return to the Lord, to come back to His loving arms. He's ready to celebrate with you, to forgive you of your sins, to call you His own. And so if you are ready, I want to pray this prayer for you right now, for you to make Jesus the Lord of your heart. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, I want to thank you for this night. Forgive me of my sins. I am ready to be called your child of God. Come into my heart. Save me from my sins. Rescue me from darkness. I choose right now to repent, to make a 180, and to celebrate with you that one day I will be in heaven with you. In Jesus' name, amen. If you made that simple prayer, I want to just say congratulations. I rejoice with the angels saying, glory to God, glory in the highest. You are now in the kingdom of God. You will be in heaven with Jesus from this very day forward. I want to encourage you to make sure that you get a Bible. Leave me a comment below so I can send you a Bible. Or you can just simply on your app, on YouTube, just type in Romans 1 or Psalm 1 and begin to listen to the Bible, and God will begin to help you. I also want to encourage you to get connected to a church where the Bible is taught with love and with grace. And I want to encourage you to come to my church or to go to a church where your family goes. Make sure that it's a church that speaks of the love of God, of the grace found in Jesus, and you will begin to grow. I just want to thank you for sharing this broadcast. If you have a relative that you are saying, man, I wish they had heard this message, share this broadcast with your friend. Let them know that Jesus has the answers to all of our worries right now, that there is a virus that's even more dangerous than the coronavirus. It's called sin. It's called that emptiness in our hearts. And yet, don't despair, because God has conquered the world. He has conquered every disease. He has conquered every illness. And if you are someone who has knowledge of Jesus, you are a Christian, but as I mentioned earlier, you have one foot in the world and one foot in the church, I want to encourage you to come back 100% to God. God will bless you. God will give you peace if you make Him your Lord and Savior, and you make Him your 100. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you for sharing this broadcast. Thank you for being here. Make sure that you give towards this ministry by clicking on the link at the bottom of this video so that this message of hope can go out to the world. I believe that this is a time for us who love God to speak of His message, of His love and His grace to the world, because the world is looking for answers, and we know that those answers are found in Jesus. Thank you again for watching, and I will see you next time.
David Trigg, producer T-Reg.